of the IVF Center here in Orlando, Florida. Nice to see you all again, or be with you all again. You know, we started talking about recurrent miscarriage about 2 weeks ago, and then we had an interruption for late breaking news about the uterine transplant. Last week I got tied up, unfortunately, but we are back with you, and we're going to talk about now what is the evaluation of recurrent miscarriage and the treatment for those issues. So if you remember, recurrent miscarriage, two or more losses in the first trimester, five explanations, okay, that we evaluate for: genetic, anatomic, autoimmune, hormonal, and unexplained. Unexplained, most common, 50% of the time. The other four are 50% total, so we'll say genetic. Genetic involves looking at something called a translocation. And think of it as like a gene mutation, or a person could be a carrier of, say, sickle cell or cystic fibrosis or things like that. Well, you could be a carrier sort of an abnormality on your chromosomes. Your entire set of chromosomes are normal. The amount of information is normal. But of the 23 pairs of chromosomes, there's 22 that are non-sex, and they steal from one of the numbers, steal from the other. When they get divided up and make baby, and the egg and sperm mix, there could be an unbalanced translocation that the baby inherited, and that most commonly miscarries. Fortunately, this is only less than 5% of the time that we find that, okay? But we check a chromosome analysis of mother and father, okay? Very, very simple test. Second is anatomic, looking inside the uterus for any congenital, or things you're born with, versus acquired. Congenital, most common issue is a septum. The uterus is formed inside mom, and it comes together and then cores out. Sometimes the septum doesn't core out completely, and you're left with an indentation there. That gets often confused with a bicornuate or a two-horned uterus. Those we don't do anything about. The septum, we could do a surgery outpatient with a little telescope called the hysteroscope, put it into the uterus, and incise that septum. It opens up the uterine cavity and reduces the miscarriage. When you have a septum, probably about 44% risk of miscarriage. Once you remove it, you're back down to about 10%. Okay, very, very simple. Third is hormonal. Thyroid abnormalities, elevations in prolactin, those are pituitary hormone that can cause a desynchrony of the lining of the uterus, and also abnormal blood sugars, or particularly diabetes can increase the risk of loss. So we screen those very, very simply with three blood tests. The fourth is not really autoimmune. We call it that, but it's really antiphospholipid antibodies. These are proteins in the blood. There's a low prevalence of those for everybody, but in patients with recurrent miscarriage, we see sometimes about 10 to 15% of patients having these proteins that increase the risk of clotting around the placenta, okay? And there's three tests that we do. One of them is lupus anticoagulant, anti-cardiolipin antibody, anti-beta-2-glycoprotein. The treatment of that, if it persists and you repeat it after 3 months and they have to be still elevated, if that's the case, then actually a heparin-like substance, we used to always use heparin, and now we use low molecular weight heparin called Lovenox. And that has been shown to be very, very effective. Years ago, we used to use prednisone, but it causes more complications in pregnancy. So typically, low-dose aspirin and heparin is very, very effective, okay? So what do we do with genetic? If there's a translocation, you can still try, but you are going to have a little higher risk of miscarriage as a result of that. But ultimately, statistically, you should still have the possibility of live birth, okay? And in a patient who has a history of loss, live birth, loss, those are the ones that are more common because that's how it's dispersed, okay? Another type of treatment for that would be in vitro fertilization with chromosome analysis of baby. The outcome is probably the same whether you try naturally or with IVF, but IVF gets to probably pregnancy sooner with less miscarriage. But overall, it should be the same. What did we say? Anatomic, we talked about incising the septum. You could also have acquired polyps or fibroids. Fibroids are benign tumors. Polyps are benign little growths inside the uterus. We easily remove them surgically with the same type of hysteroscope. The hormonal issues, if thyroid is abnormal, we replace that with medication. Prolactin, we also have medication for that. Diabetes, of course, needs to get controlled before pregnancy to reduce risks of miscarriage, but also congenital anomalies and risks to the baby and also to mom. Autoimmune, we talked about Lovenox and low-dose aspirin. So the good news is that if we can find the reason, we have good outcomes. If we can't, and it's truly unexplained, then close monitoring and supportive care have been very effective. Bringing the patient in, following their blood work levels, doing ultrasounds early and throughout the first trimester, it's a TLC approach, and it's been supported in the medical literature to be effective in reducing the risk of loss. That's not to say that stress causes it, but the reassurance of the pregnancy is very, very helpful. Another thing that we do is give intramuscular progesterone injections called 17-hydroxyprogesterone caproate throughout the first trimester in unexplained loss, and that's been shown to be helpful as well. I know that's a lot of information, and we got it in just in time for our, we tried to do about 5 minutes. So nice to be with you all again. Happiest of holidays for a joyous holiday season and fulfilling New Year. Till next time, so long.